This is the back. This is We Are Here, and today we are here with Mr. Ray Anthony Shepard. We're going to talk to him about literacy, his books, and history. He is the author of Runaway, The Daring Escape of Home and Judge, and Now or Never, 54th Massachusetts Infantry's War to End Slavery, as well as a few other books. Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you very much. Nice to be here.
The first question I like to ask people to think about, like, when they were first engaging with books that they can recollect. So I wanted to ask you, did you have a favorite book in school? What was that book?
Okay, well, let me put it in context. First of all, I'm 81 years old, so we're talking in the 40s. Time when parents did with their children. And so my favorite book at school was called Ping, P-I-N-G, a story set in China about a duck who was always late and would be spanked. That's a strange thing to have as your favorite book, but it was a book that I identified.
What was your experience with reading in school? Did you have school library, public library? How did that work?
A public library. I grew up in Lincoln, Nebraska. Again, as I said, in the early 40s, I went to a University of Nebraska laboratory school that they had created for poor children, or whatever term was used then, but basically, children who were poor. And I don't recall a school library, elementary school library, but obviously the city of Lincoln had a great old library. So I spent time there.
And historically speaking, was it segregated? How did that work? I know my dad is from Tennessee, and he didn't even have a library until he went to college, but some of the libraries around him were segregated.
Right.
So how did that work?
Because the black or colored population at Lincoln at that time was quite small, there was no segregation. Mm-hmm. We were, in my high school class, I think when I was growing up, there were maybe 30 black families. City of 30,000 at that. So our neighborhood was relatively integrated with people of Mexican descent, Native American descent, and all whites.
Did you feel discrimination? Did you feel othered in school when you were learning and things of that nature? Did you feel that were fairly well integrated within the community?
It was a mixed combination. There's the reality. I described the neighborhood, but over time, by the time I reached junior high, it was primarily a black neighborhood. So yeah. There was white flight in Detroit. There was no question about jobs were color coded. Mm-hmm. The newspapers. The one ads had large, long columns for white men, slightly smaller column for white women, then colored men, and then colored women, which was, of course, the smallest, not of course, but was the smallest. So my father was never able to get a mortgage in a neighborhood that for a house. And no black men had jobs in town. Mm-hmm. The exception being one University of Nebraska football player was a janitor at the city waterworks. Mm-hmm. Most of the men who worked on the railroad outside of my father's case worked in Chicago, would ride the train overnight to Chicago, get on a train, and cook all the way to California, back, get off the train, and come back home.
Wow.
So every 6 days, every other 6 days. Mm-hmm. So it was, you felt, I don't know if you'd even call it discrimination. It was the world you lived in. At school, it was quite integrated. And so it wasn't that you were oblivious to race. And then, of course, the importance of the Black church, which is key in my life.
So with that in mind and thinking about literacy, what did your culture of literacy look like? What were those patterns and people in your life? Or do you feel that literacy was forefronted for you, or do you feel that it was something that you kind of fell into and you went to the love of it? Was it highly supported at home in terms of, did you have a lot of books or things like that? How did that work?
It was very confusing and very mixed. My father was not a big believer in higher education or education as far as that was concerned. He felt that it, like on the railroad, guys who had college degrees were still working as porters in the train. So he saw no benefit. My mother, on the other hand, was different. She had her own literary aspirations and tried to write for attempted to get published in romance magazines. We had in school, I read no Black authors until I was in college. But at church, you were exposed to Black authors. And I'm going to really date myself. My mom, when I was maybe 8 or 9, my mom took me to hear Langston Hughes, who was at the Urban League. Visiting. And so you had these literary moments, but they were moments.
Mm-hmm. I just need to back up. Mm-hmm. You mentioned Langston Hughes.
Yeah.
Were you aware of, you know, the significance of what he meant at that time?
Absolutely.
So you just saw him and years later it was like, wow.
Right.
Okay.
It was more something humbling.
Okay.
Yeah. Just do what your parents tell you.
That's pretty awesome. So when you think about your path in reading, did you have a reading role model and who would that have been?
No. Reading was not, even though my mother had these aspirations to write romance magazines and there were, I'm not sure where they came from, but there were books in the house, but they were more for display. Mm-hmm. For me, my interest in writing came from storytelling, like, came from two sources. One, the radio, and two, when we went back to my parents, to my grandmother's house in Missouri, I had a grand uncle who loved to tell stories. And I'm not making this up. We would sit around at a Potbelly stove, and they would, what my mother called, they would be telling lies. And I would just be in the corner listening. And it was just fantastic. And on the radio, I would be in the kitchen when mom was cooking dinner, I'd be in the kitchen listening to Lone Ranger, Cisco. And other radio shows. There were 15-minute radio dramas.
When did you start to write?
I think I, seeing my mother and seeing and the rejection letters made me want to write. But I had a learning disability, so it was always a struggle. But I remember in 9th grade, I used to sell newspapers on the corner, and one of the spots of selling newspapers was in front of a typewriter store. and I got to know the owner, who allowed me to buy an Underwood portable typewriter for $1. And so I would sit on my porch and type, and all I could type was the end. And I was determined one day I would be right. So thanks to a long life, I've been able to achieve. But it was a struggle for me. Literacy was a struggle. Reading was a struggle. Writing was a struggle. Writing still was a struggle.
How did you overcome your reading difficulties? What helped?
Just stubborn determination. Again, grew up in an era where the old folks would say, get your education. Well, you can't take that away from them. They can't take it away. But they, of course, misunderstood. So, like Frederick Douglass talks about when Sophia, who's teaching him at least the letters, and her husband stops her and says, it doesn't make for a good slave. And it, he later would write, that became my pathway to literacy. And I think when the Otok said, get your education, they can't take that away from you, became my pathway to literacy. Again, long struggle. It's not, no one should think some magic wand tapped me and then I was suddenly literate.
And I think that's a key thing to focus on in terms of some people that I talk to, it comes easy and they have exposure, and some people have to work at it. And it's okay to have that struggle, the incremental struggle to get there. Sometimes I think, especially when I was teaching young boys, there was that point where this is too hard, I'm done. Mm-hmm. So I like that you focus on having that determination. So you were in high school and then you go to college and you say you see the library for the first time. What was that like?
Well, you're at the University of Nebraska had a fantastic library. But again, I had no idea that I was going to go to college until spring of my senior year when homeroom teacher asked who was going to University of Nebraska as if any other schools. And all the kids I sort of admired, if not envy, raised their hands. So I raised mine, and afterwards the teacher after class called me up and said, you know, you haven't been in a college prep curriculum. You're not prepared. But it was a state university, and I suppose it had a 99.9% acceptance rate. Mm-hmm. So I applied and was accepted.
What was that learning curve like?
Extremely difficult. It's excruciating. In fact, I flunked out, and then I went to the Army, and I spent 3 years in the Army, stationed in Germany. And that's, and basically taught myself the army base had a terrific library. And I would spend most of my evenings and weekends in the base library. Determined. That's where I discovered James Baldwin, Bob Ellison, Richard Wright. People I've never heard of. I guess I can't just never heard of. Apparently, Paul and Swinburne, 19 years, was the extent of it. That came to the church, not to the school. Mm-hmm.
So, as you're starting to read these, especially these black males, what was going through your mind? What were what were you processing at the time?
Well, I was just amazed. You couldn't help but identify. It wasn't so much identifying with the characters in the story, so much as identifying with, here are guys who look like me, who are doing what I wanted to do, but so many people, including in my own family, had said was impossible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this harkens back to you on the idea of representation and how important that is in literature and representing that nature. So you leave the army and you head to school, and is this where you decide you want to be a history teacher?
Yes, well, I come back, and even though I flunked out, Nebraska is a land grant school. They have to let veterans, give veterans another chance, mm-hmm. one semester chance. And I re-enrolled as a 23-year-old freshman, mm-hmm. Survived, and graduated 4 years while working full-time 4 years. I was a prison guard at the state penitentiary. Because of my military training, and a student. And this is the 60s, and you know, all the imagine the protests, and here I am in my prison guard uniform going to class. I graduated in 4 years and moved to Iowa to teach on the teaching job in Iowa. Got there for 2 years. Got a fellowship to
So I have to step back too and talk about this. So during the 60s and you're in school and things like that, were there any other authors or people that influenced the way that you approached, maybe even thinking about history or just your ideology and things like that?
Well, when I was in the class and the author was, or the book was Invisible Man. And I understood the book at a deeper level than my classmates. And I sort of realized my love for literary analysis. So it's not that I came in contact with authors other than through books. But anyhow, that's and I'm here in the Boston area going to graduate school.
What was that like, going to Harvard all of a sudden from someone who was like, you know, I'm sure when you were growing up, that might not have been the foremost thing in your mind. Is that probably I'm going to go, wow. Yeah.
It wasn't. And when I mentioned that, when I was teaching and mentioned I was going to be fine, fellow teachers sort of chuckled. Mm-hmm. And then I remember driving from Iowa to Cambridge in the summer and arriving in Cambridge, Harvard Square, and they're playing bongo drums and smoking marijuana, and I thought, it's so different from Iowa or Nebraska, but it was all good.
So you taught a few years and you mm-hmm. got that experience, and then you go to Harvard where they have access to everything. I assume it was probably the same then, to have just having access to things you would never imagine.
And surrounded by students who were exceptional. So you started to, it took a while to make sure that you could get over feeling like an imposter. But it was the total environment, mm-hmm. environment. Meeting other writers, poets here and a couple of them in the Boston area who were either at Emerson or Boston University. And being at the ed school at Harvard, it was like there were people who weren't studying to be teachers, but studying to be superintendents of schools. secretaries of education. So it was like,
how did that experience change your teaching at all?
I think I became a more serious teacher, moved beyond textbooks, and wanting students to see American history as in a more nuanced way. Nuances. A more honest way. Mm-hmm. So, and in terms of teaching models, showing students how to do a deeper read, mm-hmm. a closer read. So, that, and I was always, I'm going to digress.
That's absolutely fine.
Here's what drives my writing in some way. In school in Nebraska, American history is taught fifth grade, eighth grade, 11th grade. You get the same story three times. But in the 40s and 50s, when I was growing up, we were left, that is, the African American experience is canceled, doesn't exist. And so you're growing up with this one sense of we have no history. And in another sense, when slavery is taught, I've written about this, how I've always felt embarrassed because I was one of the few Black kids in this laboratory school. And slavery is, I think, still today, taught in a way that perhaps it's superficial, and Black kids feel embarrassed. I think white kids can feel guilty, and together Black and white kids will say today, enough already. I was never a slave, I was never a slave master. So I had this embarrassing experience of there were slaves. And then I would go home, my mother would talk about her father who was born in slavery. He was enslaved until he was 6 years old. He was emancipated in 65, January of 65, when Missouri did their own emancipation 2 years after the emancipation proclamation. So I've got my mother talking about her father and his father, who was also his owner. And then I've got school. And so I think in my storytelling, I come back to this what Martin Luther King called the why. And he talks about after the Selma March, no lie can last forever. So it's this pulling the curtain off of this lie, but in such a way that kids, regardless of ethnicity or race, identify with the hero or the main character.
It's interesting, again, it's a cycle, right? Mm-hmm. I think that at this point in time, we're in the exact same place. And I'm still struggling with the lie.
Yeah. Yes, and we're, I mean, the pushback is coming through from the so-called catch-all of critical race theory is brilliant propaganda part, and it's having an impact on schools. It's having an impact. What books get in the school library, certainly in the classroom. Teachers, I did a series of workshops with teachers this spring with teachers in the Panhandle of Florida, basically what one might call the redneck country. Mm-hmm. They were very open, very wonderful teachers, but they were petrified on how to teach race, stories about race, in a way that, one, didn't give them trouble with the school board. Mm-hmm. Two, it didn't embarrass the few black students that we had. Three, not make their white students feel guilty. It's a challenge that I think the propagandists in our country will not allow us to fully explore. No one would, to use an example of Germany. The Holocaust is taught in German schools. Without Germans, kids feeling guilty or embarrassed, horrified at what happened. But it doesn't, they recognize that this, they were not responsible. Mm-hmm. Here we don't seem to have that luxury. And so you get the response, well, I'm not a racist, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
So you, when I've heard you speak before, and what I was so appreciative of, is that you have different styles of teaching, and you know, some teachers will go on and be very militant about what they teach, but you're so matter of fact and making connections and things like that, it makes it normal. When you talk about it, you know, so it's not like this thing that would shock somebody and be like, you know, something that would alarm. No, it just seems like this is history. What advice do you have for the seekers when they feel like they're in this predicament and they just want to teach different history through different lenses?
Yeah. You know? Well, I think distance is important. It is. And also intellectual honesty. If you're teaching, if you're teaching the Roman Empire, you're not likely to be a zealot or a militant or feel that you have to somehow tone it down. You're teaching the facts, and you're allowing students to understand the facts from a more perspective. So how do we do that? The challenge is how to do that when you're teaching the American Revolution, the Civil War, the Civil Rights Movement. I'm going to come back to this, let's stop for a minute and say, if you're teaching the Declaration of Independence and you come across this line of Jefferson about blaming the king for the savage Indians, and that's in the Declaration of Independence still today, how do you teach that? How do you teach a declaration, that particular line, and help kids understand it? All men created. Certainly didn't mean women. It didn't mean the enslaved. It didn't mean the Indian. And how do you do that without saying, so therefore our country, I like to avoid this is not something I believe, but it opens you up to the challenge. We're saying the country is racist, rather than the country had policies which were race-based. And that's more than a semantic difference. sorry.
No, that this is amazing because people are going into classrooms, you know, as we speak, worried about this issue.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
and
for
so
sure.
So it's very now, if we're looking at, you've had experience in terms of editing textbooks and things like that.
Right.
So were you worried? How did you approach this when you're thinking about history books with different lenses? Because here at Boston College at the ERC, we have different social studies books, so people can see, you know, the lenses that people are taking, what's there, what's submitted, and things like that. How did you approach this? What were you? Did you feel like you were constrained? And what are some of the things that people will need to look for now when they're about curriculum?
Okay. May I just go back to one thing and then I'll come back to
yep.
your question. Even though I've talked a lot about slavery and civil rights, et cetera, for teachers, you know, I can speak directly to teachers, it's important to know that Black kids, white kids, all kids, in reading about a Black character or subject, need stories that are more than slavery, civil rights, or police brutality. So that they have, Jacqueline Woodson talks about this a lot, and she, her books are excellent examples of this, and so is, there are other writers. So it's important that in terms of books, there's Jerry Craft, there's Jacqueline Woodson, Kwame Alexander. There are other writers, and they're usually in fiction, who are giving us a fuller version of Black life. Now, I write biographies. I write about Black subjects in biographies. Therefore, I can't avoid, or I choose not to avoid, the issue of race and history. But I don't make these kind of books the steady diet of your so-called diverse offerings. Now, back to your question as a textbook editor. Well, understand, I'm a young man who wants a career, who has, you know, family and mortgage and all the things that make up life. So I'm trying to carve out a career in education publishing, and at the same time recognizing that the public, states, create a curriculum. You create a textbook that matches that curriculum. Now that may sound like, well, therefore I compromise my value. It's a challenge. It's a challenge to produce a book that meets the requirements of certain key states. For instance, but you do it in the way, the best way you can. Can't really think of examples. I'll just say this. For instance, in Texas, of course, comes on, you know, big. But Texas and California, Florida, are some of the largest states. And when I was in publishing, perhaps it's changed now. But in Texas, the Civil War, it's only recently that they allowed, acknowledged that the cause of the Civil War was slavery. Before that was not accepted. So you have challenges. I'm not answering this in a way.
It's very real.
Yeah, you know? A real and honest way.
Yes, it's very real and it's complex.
And understand the risks. I was as editor in chief, I had the responsibility. So you would spend. Here's one example of. I thought I figured it out. The controversy was always in Texas was always about are you a patriot? Do you love America? So I produced a program, spent $60 million to produce it. It's a company spent $60 million. It was called We the People, and it showed We the People. State board called me multicultural, culturally chic. The book was a disaster. The series was a disaster. The company lost a lot of money. I had this mistaken idea that if I showed how others aspired to participate in the American promise, that would make radical conservatives less hostile. Mm-hmm. That was very nice. And so one of the nice things now about what I'm writing is I'm writing books that I couldn't publish when I was an editor.
I think a point that always has to be centered in this is that people immediately go to these ends of an issue. It's mm-hmm. just so complex. Mm-hmm. And we have to learn, even in terms of teaching, to teach complexity.
Right.
And to understand that it's not just a cut and dry issue and how to live in that space. I think that's a lot of what's missing is to have that, to sit in that for a while. We're always just looking for answer, and sometimes you just have to sit and respect that there's not an easy answer. We might not find an answer, but we can have these iterations of change and thinking different, hearing different ideas.
And if teaching, if we teaching about American government, American history, American people, we have to recognize the government. The people who create government, the government, have all the customs, social history, biases that they have as individuals, and it gets translated into government policy. So you can have a segregated army. Legally, you can have different water companies. You can have federal government, home mortgage companies requiring a brick wall between the black neighborhoods and the white neighborhoods in Detroit. And that wall still stands. So that's the complexity that we are still in. It's still the hangover that we're in.
Another point too that I like to bring out that you talked about is finding also the positive things, because again it always focuses kind of on a deficit thing. Mm-hmm. For example, like with Greenwood, people mm-hmm. want to focus on a massacre per se, but let's focus on the fact that we had this city, this town, this aspect mm-hmm. of town that was self-sufficient, that had that was economically successful and all this and the joy and normalcy that black people were able to have in this space. So I think too, when teachers are thinking about presenting information, to find those moments, mm-hmm. Where we had positive impacts, on history, instead of just coming from an aspect. Because I too sat in class, and when we talked about slavery, everyone turned and looked at me.
Right.
And
right.
I was just like, what? Right. I'm from Cleveland.
Slave.
Right, I'm from Cleveland. What is this?
Yeah. I've been in classrooms and I've seen that. I was never a slave.
Right.
And in fact, the book I just finished, I start with, each section starts with a personal poem. And it addresses that issue.
Okay.
Yeah.
I could talk to you forever. I'm gonna try to keep going.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I'm
obviously enjoying myself too.
So I wanted to talk about these two books in particular. So to step back a little bit, we're talking about the times we're in. I had with one of my friends, I had a great discussion about this book, and we were talking about
Ona.
And how to present discussions about enslaved Africans in class, and how would you suggest? You do provide a great guide and things like that, but if you could give some pointers on thinking about the viewpoint of this perspective is from an enslaved person. It's not this author coming in and things like that. So can you explain your thought behind this book and how you, use prose or, like this repeated verse to kind of go through it? Can you speak on this book a little bit and what teachers, can take away from this?
Well, a couple of things. It's told from Una's point of view. Not intended expense or dig at George Washington, but Ona's point of view, Ona's perspective. And secondly, it is, we have the traditional understanding, the common understanding about slavery, teaching slavery in schools. It's the abused field work. The scars on the back, the hard labor. That's not to say that Ona didn't do hard labor. But so here's another aspect of slavery. You have someone who is mixed race, who has what I will call, say, is the best job a slave could ever have. She's a special pet. Washington. The Washingtons preferred to have mixed race servants in the house. Her mother and both met that requirement. So right away you're confronted or presented with another aspect of enslavement, American slavery. Secondly, it works as a poem, and it is told in a way to entice the reader to quickly understand her plight. Okay, she's got this great wife, closet full of clothes, well treated. She's not mistreated physically, but the desire for personal freedom, liberty, is greater than the material world. And so the emphasis is on the language. It gets you quickly to her story, and it raises the question, Ona Judge, why you run away, Ona Judge? Getting the reader into this quest, this basic human quest for individual liberty.
I like too that you use the vernacular as well. Mm-hmm. I think that's important that we start seeing more of that all the time in our literature and things like that. This reminded me of something that I forgot to talk about, and I think it lends with Now or Never, is if we have textbooks and, teachers are always thinking about how to supplement them, and you do a lot of great work in terms of primary resources, right? The actual things. Talk about your experience with that and maybe why teachers and kids even should think about, what primary sources can be in terms of learning.
Well, it puts you in touch with the actual individual that you're writing about, or that as a writer that you're presenting to the reader, you get to hear and read the words of that individual. And in the case where I have the first two Civil War correspondents, you get their firsthand reports of what it was like to be a soldier in the Civil War, where you had to fight two wars. You had to fight the Confederates and you had to fight the Union Army. And then you get to see the difference between the two in terms of Gooding wrote for an abolitionist paper, primarily a white readership. Stevens wrote for a black newspaper, primarily black readership, and you see the difference. But he never has few negative words about the situation until he gets fed up and he sits down. He writes Abraham Lincoln. Stevens, on the other hand, is in your face all the time.
And one of the things too that this is for middle grade starting. I was reading and I was like, wait, it took me until I was well into my adulthood to learn that there was an educated class of black people, which I think was so important to learn about as well. And to understand here in Massachusetts, that role. I mean, I was from Ohio. It would have been such a foreign concept for me to even understand that. All I was taught that, we never read and we never did this, but to understand that there were these communities that there were public schools and communities that, like literary societies and things of that nature.
Yeah, sure, the Vatican Society. Mm-hmm. Oh, no. But being from Ohio, at Oberlin,
that's true.
With mm-hmm. Langston and Langston Hughes, and with others, you had these literary societies. But there were many black newspapers. People think Frederick Douglass, North Star is one of the first. It's not true. And believe it or not, even in the South, 10% of blacks were literate. Mm-hmm. Number quite higher in the North. So.
I think that's important too, because we have a history of this. Mm-hmm. We have a history of even when in the South, when it was prohibited, people were ensuring that if they could, some of their kids could read. And I think that's important too, because we have to realize that we're from that history of making it happen without a majority population, supporting us, if you will. So.
Yeah, and can be punished for it.
That's true.
Harriet Tubman's Minister Green was sentenced to 10 years in prison for owning a copy of Harriet Beecher Stowe's book. So,
yeah, you're right. Even the parallels now to those who are allies.
I think for kids and for teachers, using primary sources sort of say, first of all, it's proof. This is not fantasy, this is not fiction. This is hard proof that these guys existed. I went through, they produced maybe 100 war dispatches. Mm-hmm. So I used their real writing, their war dispatches to weave that story.
Was it hard for you to, because using primary resources, one of the things is that you really have to together these things that might not always be a cohesive set. So can you talk about that aspect of it in terms of learning how to navigate some archives and things of that nature?
Well, we're fortunate, I'm fortunate to live in the Boston area, because the amount of resources is just terrific. Between the Anthony and the Mass Historical Society, the Holt Library at Harvard, and the Massachusetts Archives, State Archives out of Boston. Boston, at University of Massachusetts, at Boston, is just tremendous resources. So then it's a question of, it's like, in many ways, it's like what a good collage artist does. You're taking pieces and you're assembling, arranging them into something. A new vision, a new picture. So I'm taking pieces of real life and organizing them, being faithful to the true, into a narrative art. So it's your judgment of, well, where do you start? How do you increase the emotional pull of the crisis, and how do you bring it back down? And you're finding examples.
Yes. What I like too, and I think what makes primary sources so important or a great resource to use in classrooms too, is, hey, I went to a museum even once, and the archivist handed me a piece of paper that had the partial poem written by Langston Hughes in my hand with his signature and everything. And that was just like, I'm touching what he touched.
Right.
You know what I mean? And looking at what he, so that's kind of, it connected me different to that, you know, to that history, and it had more meaning in a sense. When I got to see this, and when you actually look at the handwriting, this is what, you know, those type of things, it kind of changes the way you look at history. For some people, it's just so, you know, rote, boring. I think sometimes primary resources can help change that perspective.
Yes. And true. Mm-hmm. And also the teacher has to move beyond the textbook to get the kids into the lives of them.
Yes.
And even the person who, the individual who seems the most unimportant, most uninteresting, is interesting.
Yes.
And you have a job to reveal that as a teacher and certainly as a writer.
Thank you so much. That I again want to pivot a little bit and talk about the illustrations that went into the Ono one. Were you worried, or how did you collaborate to make sure that what was getting across was coming across, and what were some of the things that you had to consider? And you had a great illustrator. Great illustrator. So how did that collaboration work?
Well, it started with having a great editor who sent me drawings of two or three illustrators. And I said, not that I had veto power, because the writers don't, it's up to the publisher. But I expressed how much I like Keith of the drawing. Someone I've never met, never spoken to. He's in San Diego. We've communicated via email. His work is gorgeous. One review of the book called his illustrations, sort of American Girl illustrations. And what I liked about that, whether the reviewer meant it that as a compliment, I think I suppose they did. But what I liked about it is it goes to the heart of, again, of let's tell another aspect of slavery, of someone who has who's not in the field, who's not being physically abused, and so this then, his illustrations make it possible to see her, and it drives home the question, why would you run away? Look at you.
Got a name, right?
Somebody's bringing a car away, you got the room for yourself. You're in the best district in Philadelphia, housing district in Philadelphia.
We Were you worried at all at first when you're like, you take all this time to create this text and you research and understand, and you're handing it over to someone's visual, you know?
No. Again, I have Grace, who's the editor of this book, was just super. I had terrific confidence in her. Now, there were some, and Keith wasn't familiar with Ona, the person of Ona, or the story. And so, like, the one drawing of where he's in, where they're in the kitchen, that before she...
Is that one with Hercules?
Well, Hercules, but no, with Austin, the waiter. But they had...
it's absolutely...
Here, they had, it was sort of more of a traditional looking enslaved servant as opposed to someone in livery, formally dressed. And so that was one of the things I asked to be changed. But it wasn't, there weren't, you know, it made any major thing. He's just a great artist, illustrator.
He is the connection of this looks so. This I've seen this person.
Yes.
You know what I mean. So that's what makes this interesting. Also, this reminds me of the book Brick by Brick, and so it just if I was I could do like a text set with this, but it's just beautifully done. And here at DRC, we paired this book with The Bell Rang, and it provides both aspects of someone who was, you know, the house enslaved person versus someone who was in the field, and those two different experiences in a very real way.
Right.
And the consequences of the person that was, for The Bell Rang, who was in the field, you know, you felt that felt something. So I think hearing these two books, even for high school students to have to understand the nuances of what happened would be a great way to talk about this. Let's see. Oh, I wanted to just to point out some of the themes that I saw that I was, if that students will be so lucky to have this experience now, as opposed to me being an adult learning about this later. The issues in this book alone, class, historical politicians, Hercules and his story, the status positions of the enslaved, the underground sea, which there's a picture book of, but that fugitive slave ads, with which there's a lot of information online, which teachers can use, and people as possessions and humanity. Like that alone, in a 32-page, what someone, a picture book,
Well, one thing with poetry, it's compression. With picture books, it's compression. You attempt to tell a deep story in a very compressed way.
Mm-hmm. And this provides a lot of jumping off points to learn about different things, which is why, you know, both of these books are so worthwhile for instruction. Yes.
Thank you.
You did what you did. You did it.
Right.
On that one.
Yeah.
Let's see here. So I want to talk about, get kind of turn back to literacy, if I can. And specifically with Black boys and young Black men. I think what advice would you give, or how do we engage boys more with reading and literacy? What are your thoughts about that?
I'm going to go back to the Frederick Douglass quote earlier. When he's forbidden, or Sophia is forbidden to teach him of the alphabet, and he says, "I found my pathway to literacy." literacy is a way out of this is a pathway to being to the class. It's a pathway to personal freedom. It's a pathway to self-confidence. It's, you know, bringing another book. So when Langston Hughes says, they will see how beautiful I am. Literacy can help the reader see how beautiful they are. And this is important, literacy is not limited to words on a page. If you listen closely to rap lyrics, or even country western lyrics, if you listen to preachers, you listen to politicians, newscasters, you listen to people who are succeeding. Literacy is an ability, a high level of articulation, elegance in articulation is a common denominator. So whether it's Al Sharpton or Frederick Douglass or Barack Obama, you know, or anyone, you're going to hear that. Mm-hmm. And it's how an individual learns to love themselves.
All of that. Yes, let me take that in. I think too that literacy comes in different forms, which mm-hmm. I think is a things that sometimes people aren't aware of. There's visual literacy, you know, like auditory literacy.
Yeah,
so,
sure.
And we really have to pay attention to kind of what rings true for us, like how we take in that information and use that to our advantage.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a hard thing to learn and realize for people. That, you know, sometimes it's not just always these words on a page. Sometimes you have to hear it first and get a greater context and things.
But yeah, it's mm-hmm. more about how you think the obligation you have to self.
I have a question here, and this one was from Kevin. What, as adults of all backgrounds, can be done now for our young Black readers to become interested in the possibility of becoming a teacher, a writer, a librarian? You know what I mean? Like, what advice would you give?
It's interesting. At one point in my career or life, I thought about becoming a librarian. Certainly. I think those who are sort of lifelong learners are the ones who follow that path. So how do you spark curiosity to want to learn? And the way to learn is that you learn a subject is to ask the teacher or to write about it. I'm sure I'm not going to be very helpful here, but it's about people who are intellectually curious mm-hmm. and have this innate need to serve or to help become teachers.
What about for writing? What would you suggest about the possibility of a young Black male in writing,